Welcome along, ladies and gentlemen. You're in for a treat today. You are going to like this debate. We're going to be reviewing Kent Hovind when he defeated Michael Shermer, or as I call him, Michael Squirmer, because he is not able to prove that evolution is accurate and correct. He's not able to debunk Kent Hovind's proof and evidence. So you are going to like this debate. So I'm going to be pointing out a few of the highlights of the debate, and you can go to debatesonvideo.blogspot.com to see the entire debate. It lasts for a while, so you can check it out. One of the things you're going to notice is Michael Shermer really squirms a lot because he doesn't really have proof and evidence for evolution and for the age of the earth and for things like that. And Kent Hovind is calm, cool, confident, and he even brings proof and evidence. You could see Kent Hovind there with his laptop. He's got data, he's got evidence. It kind of seems to me, and you're going to probably agree with me when you see this, that Michael Shermer is just making it up as he goes along, you know. And it's really great because Mr. Hovind calls out Michael Shermer. And this is why we call Michael Shermer Michael Squirmer. So let's begin. You're in for a treat. All right, guys, so here we go. Listen to this question. First, he's going to ask the Squirmer.
Dr. Shermer, regarding bird evolution, is there any living or fossil evidence that a leg became a wing and a scale became a feather?
Now, did you hear that? Any evidence at all? Now, he has to provide, Michael Shermer, as I'm calling him, Michael Squirmer, he has to provide proof and evidence of this, and he doesn't. He just wants us to take us at his word. Watch this. And then we're going to go to Kent Hovind after this and watch how Kent Hovind basically points out that Michael Shermer is full of it.
Yeah, good question. There's actually a fair amount of good evidence now for...
All right, let's see if he offers any. What?
...for the evolution of birds from dinosaurs and the transition from scales to feathers.
Okay, let's see if he offers any. What is it?
And the transition from walking limbs to flying limbs. It operates in principle... with the slide I put up with the each part has a particular function that served some other purpose that in the end got co-opted for a different purpose.
He's not giving any evidence. You notice that? He's talking about some other slide about things with purpose. He's not answering the question. So we're going to go back because I want you to notice this is a very dishonest atheist technique where he tries to get you sidetracked where you forget what the heck the question was. So watch how he tries to get you sidetracked, but then we're going to go back to the question. And if you pay close attention, he doesn't provide any proof and evidence. He doesn't even answer the question. Watch.
And the wing is a classic example. Almost surely was once a thermodynamic regulator, a heat regulator, which then gets co-opted to use for something else later. Therefore, a half a wing has some purpose. In terms of the fossil record, it's pretty good now. We actually have quite a few transitional fossils from dinosaurs to birds. And there's a number of paleontologists that think today the dinosaurs are still living, not as dragged.
Now you notice he hasn't offered any. He's just saying, yeah, that we have some. Where are they? He hasn't offered any. Let's go back to the question. So Michael Shermer, someone click share below this video and send this to him. Michael, listen, man, just answer the question. You guys, you atheists aren't doing yourself any favors by squirming out of the question. Let's go back to the question, and I want you to pay close attention here. This is a very dishonest technique that atheists do. They make good politicians, though. You know, well, it all depends on what is. I mean, you know, I did not have relations with it. I mean, it's almost like a politician. So let's go back to the question, and you're going to notice he doesn't answer it. Here's the question. Okay, listen to the question. We're going to let it play through this time. Watch how he doesn't answer it.
Okay, Dr. Shermer, regarding bird evolution, is there any living or fossil evidence that a leg became a wing and a scale became a feather?
Yeah, good question. There's actually a fair amount of good evidence now for the evolution of birds from dinosaurs and the transition from scales to feathers and the transition from walking limbs to flying limbs. It operates in principle with the slide I put up with the each part has a particular function that served some other purpose that in the end got co-opted for a different purpose. And the wing is a classic example, almost surely was once a thermodynamic regulator, a heat regulator, which then gets co-opted to use for something else later. Therefore, a half a wing has some purpose. In terms of the fossil record, it's pretty good now. We actually have quite a few transitional fossils from dinosaurs to birds. And there's a number of paleontologists that think today the birds, the dinosaurs are still living, not as dragons in the Bible. By the way, where are the unicorns that are referred to in the Bible? Where are those, either in the fossil record or today?
Let me break in here. I wanted to tell you something. You know, when it's saying unicorn in the Bible, it's not referring to like a My Little Pony unicorn. I want to show you what just happened last month. You probably heard it. Look what they discovered. This is not a joke. Check this out. If you type in unicorn fossil discovered, this is what a unicorn looks like. A lot of biblical scholars and creationists. And by the way, everyone's a creationist. Even atheists are creationists. I'm going to prove it to you. They just believe that something else created. So everyone's a creationist, okay? But check this out. Notice it says researchers have found, they're calling it a Siberian unicorn. And this is basically what it is referring to when scripture is talking to a unicorn. There's videos on YouTube where they're talking about it basically being very similar looking to like a rhinoceros. But when you think unicorn, the way the atheists, because they're dishonest, the way the atheists promote it is they talk about it like it's a My Little Pony unicorn. Now, this was this year, last month, in March, when they discovered this. It's all over the internet. It's all over the news. And uni, as you know, means one, and unicorn here. So let's get back to the debate where Kent Hovind basically talks about how Michael Squirmer, as I call him, is just full of it. Watch. Okay, so let's see how Mr. Hovind.
Okay, I disagree strongly. Every one of the so-called evidences for dinosaurs turning to birds have been proven wrong. Archaeoraptor was listed as proof for evolution, the missing link. National Geographic, breaking news, we found the missing link. A couple of months later, oops, we got fooled. Some Chinese guy glued a bird tail on a reptile and sold it for $80,000, and the Smithsonian bought it. As a Chinese smuggler brought it in, a great embarrassment to modern paleontology from USA Today. We'd go all day about that. The tail was added by an entrepreneurial Chinese farmer. Yep. Which one you want to talk about?
Now, have you noticed the evolutionist atheists never want to bring that up? They don't talk about when it was debunked. They only talk about different theories they have. What has to happen for people to buy into evolution is they've got to prove it. They've got to prove this first. And then people will buy into it. You don't just buy into it on faith. What I've noticed is it's the atheists that are the ones buying into evolution, but I still don't understand why they would, because it is lacking proof and evidence. In fact, we did a radio show on this. I'm going to put a annotation on this video, and you can click it, where we go through some really scary things for the atheist, evolutionist, naturalist, where with the new discoveries of modern science, evolution is toast, guys. The Darwinian theory of evolution, it is toast. Sorry, Aaron Raw. Sorry, Thunderfoot. Sorry, atheist on YouTube. It is toast. It is toast. So let's go through some more of these things that were basically frauds that were perpetuated onto the scientific community because people are so desperate to find this missing link. Let's continue. Watch this. Watch how Kent Hovind just totally demolishes Michael Squirmer here.
Archaeoraptor, the little dino fuzz, they call it. We got plenty of stuff on that. Video number 4, folks, you need that one. This dino fuzz is not dino fuzz at all. It's just simply a chemical reaction that takes place as things fossilize, and it's been proven over and over. There's considerable body of evidence that these fossil traces known as dino fuzz have nothing to do with feathers, Alan Fiducia writes, and he believes in evolution. So you're mistaken about that. Thank you.
Okay. Let's show you a couple more clips from this. Don't forget, you can go to debatesonvideo.blogspot.com to see the whole debate. I mean, it's over 2 hours long. It is excellent. You know, here's the thing, guys. Everyone is a creationist. Every single person watching this video is a creationist. When I was an atheist, I was also a creationist. Every atheist is a creationist. The Amazing Atheist on YouTube, he's a creationist. I'm going to prove it to you. Aaron Raw, who I call Aaron Wrong, he's a creationist. The Thunderfoot, he's a creationist. Every single atheist, and even if they call themselves atheist evolutionists, they're creationists. See, they believe that things were created. These species, these animals were created. Humans were created. They believe that. Everyone believes that, right? But what they believe is that the dirt just magically brought it into existence. And this existence came out of chaos. Atheists believe in a lot of weird things. You know, Lawrence Krauss believes nothing created the universe. This is the madness of atheism. Atheists believe out of nothing, everything was created. Oh, they're creationists. But they believe nothing did it. Nothing created everything. That's what they're out there preaching. Or dirt, magic dirt just created everything. If you have a dog, have a cat, go look at your dog and cat. Atheists believe, as a direct result of the Big Bang, bada bing, your dog and cat just popped out with no intelligent design whatsoever. This is why they're creationists, but they believe that nothing did it and that dirt just did it. That's what they believe. Everyone agrees it's more rational to believe that there is intelligent design involved. This is why people are leaving atheism. This is why I left atheism. Atheism is madness. I don't have enough blind faith to believe that nothing did it. Atheists, listen, you guys can stick with nothing did it. God did it is much more logical, rational, scientific, plausible. So put that in your pipe and smoke it. So now let's get on with the rest of the debate. This is great. You're going to like this next part. Okay, so if you guys are involved with the evolution creation debate, although evolutionists are also creationists, they just believe nothing did it and magic dirt did it. They don't believe any intelligent design created. So they believe in a creationism that I cannot believe in. I believe in a true creationism. But we've all heard, well, bacteria, this is what the atheist evolutionists are trying to convince people, but no one's buying into their lies. They're trying to say that bacteria is proof of evolution. So listen to this, and it's actually the complete opposite. Bacteria is proof that evolution is not true. Listen to this.
Okay, this is a little bit of a long one. Bacteria appears to be the most efficient reproducing organism on the planet. What is your best evidence that for the origin of meiosis, male-female reproduction?
Well, bacteria are the dominant form of life on Earth. And in terms of how they evolved, reproductive methods has to do with really the going back to the beginnings of how monomers turn into polymers, how polymers turn into long protein chains, how long protein chains turn into something like RNA, how RNA starts to replicate into DNA, and so on, into a complex reproductive system as we see in bacteria today. We have a fairly good understanding of this in two ways. One, through the vast variety of complexity of life today, where you have from simple to complex organisms, and you can see the historical sequence in the different kinds of reproductive methods that there are, and from simple to complex, how they range. That's part one of a historical science. The same way that astronomers know how stars evolve by looking at different stars alive, if you will, today at different stages. The second way is looking at the actual cells themselves and the structures within them. These complex eukaryote cells that we're composed of are actually composed of these very simpler prokaryote cells, which we just call these little structures. Like
notice he's not really answering the question. So he always goes off on a
tangent. That were once themselves free-floating cells that through this symbiotic process of cooperation then coalesced into
these larger structures. He never
and
answers the question.
So these two ways show us, again, historical sciences are by necessary inferential, from which we have to infer from several lines of evidence. We now know this, again, through these independent lines of inquiry that converge to this same conclusion.
So he has no evidence, as you just heard.
Okay, that's a fairy tale, if I ever heard one, because it's here, it must have happened. That's like, you know, the motor slowly evolved to fit into the car, and, you know, they're like this. This is a misunderstanding and a gross oversimplification of how complex bacteria are. Bacteria are really complex. People say, don't bacteria become resistant to drugs? That's proof for evolution. Well, that's based on a misunderstanding, okay?
Now watch this. See, notice he actually gives proof and evidence and information we already know that's been proven by science. Michael Squirmer, he's kind of looking up into the air, trying to, like, making it up as he goes along. And he said that it's all based on inference. In other words, it's just based on what he wants to say it's based on, not evidence. So Michael Squirmer is saying, well, we're inferring that this is the way it is, but they don't have evidence. This here is evidence. Listen to this.
Dr. Spetner points out, it's based on a misunderstanding, for the mutations that cause antibiotic resistance still involve information loss. For example, to destroy a bacterium, the antibiotic streptomycin attaches to a part of the bacterial cell called ribosomes. Mutations sometimes cause a structural deformity in ribosomes. Since the antibiotic cannot connect with the misshapen ribosome, the bacterium is resistant. But even though this mutation turns out to be beneficial for the moment, it still constitutes a loss of information. No evolution has taken place. The bacteria are not stronger. In fact, under normal conditions with no antibiotic present, they are weaker. Example would be if somebody's going through town handcuffing everybody, hauling them off to kill them, and you don't have any arms. They can't handcuff you. So you survive the purge. Well, it might be beneficial for the moment, but it's still a loss of information and puts you back in the population with armed people, and you're going to be at a disadvantage. So, no, bacteria, this bacteria are incredibly designed, not evolved.
Okay.
Okay, guys, so now we're going to hear the overused one trick pony phrase that atheists always use is that chimp DNA is 97% similar to human DNA, which is really like 48 million difference, which I'm going to show you. It's not, you think 97%, well, that's not that bad, but it's actually 48 million in difference. So I'm going to talk to you about that. But what's really cool at this part of the debate is Michael Squirmer is saying, no, we're just like monkeys. And Kent Hovind gets a banana and throws it at Michael Squirmer, and it like lands in Michael Squirmer's mouth and it stops him from talking. No, I'm kidding. That would have been funny to do that. But no, I like it when Michael Squirmer talks because it shows the madness of atheism and, of course, atheist evolution. So Michael Shermer is a creationist. He just believes nothing did it. And random chance did it, and magical dirt did it. Mr. Hovind believes, like a rational person, that it's based on intelligent design, that God did it. I think we would all agree that God did it is much more rational and scientific than nothing did it. Now let's get to the chimp DNA, and let's debunk that real quick. Check this out.
Question for Dr. Hovind. Please explain the claim that 97% of the DNA between humans and chimp are similar.
Can you give me 10 seconds to get the slides up? And then I got 2 minutes. Okay. Here, this textbook says 96% similar between orangutans and humans, 98% similar between chimpanzees and humans, proving a common ancestor 15 million years ago. Actually, Barney Maddox was the leading genome researcher on this project. He said, concerning the genetic differences, the genetic difference between human and his nearest relative, the chimpanzee, is at least 1.6%. That doesn't sound like much, but calculated out, that's a gap of 48 million nucleotides.
Guys, 48 million. Now look at the next line. A change of only 3 is fatal. And there's a gap of 48 million. Now, why don't the atheist evolutionist, bless their sweet little primate hearts, no, I'm kidding. Why don't the atheist evolutionists ever bring up the gap of 48 million nucleotides? No, they're dishonest. Instead of talking about the nucleotides and the 48 million gap, they want to do a numbers game. And they want to talk about, well, it's 1.6%. But what does that mean? Let's get very specific. 48 million is the gap. Let's continue.
And a change of only 3 nucleotides is fatal to an animal. There is no possibility of a change. Now they've discovered instead of 98% similar, it's only 95%. So there are millions and millions of millions of differences. Now, if somebody wants to believe that proves common ancestor, they can believe whatever they want, but that's not common sense. I think it proves a common designer. That's why they're similar.
I agree with that. Common designer.
The Honda Prelude and the Honda Accord are very similar because they both evolved from a skateboard by the same logic. So the idea that the...
Now, do you hear what he just said? It makes sense. If you're driving down the street and you see a Mercedes-Benz and you see another Mercedes-Benz that is a different model, but they look similar... A rational person would say, oh, it was made in the same factory. You know, it's the same, has the same design plan, so to speak. It was made in the same factory. It has the same creator. You wouldn't say that it evolved from something else. You would obviously use logic and say that it has the same creator. It was made in the same, by the same manufacturer. It makes sense. You don't have to grasp at straws when you're a Christian creationist. Now, when you're an atheist creationist, you have to really have a lot of blind faith. Like I mentioned, the atheists believe in some weird things, guys. They believe out of nothing, everything came. Out of chaos, order arrived. Right. If you guys believe that, you will believe anything.
Back to that DNA code is supposed to prove some kind of evolutionary relationship is ludicrous, okay? The DNA code is so incredibly complex to begin with. I could point out that Microsoft PowerPoint and Microsoft Word have millions of exact lines of code. I mean, they're identical. I can click spell check in Word, and I can click spell check in PowerPoint, get the same results. That proves this all evolved from Morse code over billions of years.
Michael Shermer is squirming. Now, guys, really, DNA, they want us to believe that DNA was just created by chance. They can't say it was designed. They don't want to say it was designed. They have to believe that luck and chance and randomness created DNA. Atheists, listen closely. Give it up. Just give it up. No one's buying into it. Everyone knows you believe God exists. Everyone knows that you know God created everybody. You know that God created the universe. Everyone knows this. I don't think for 1 minute that atheists truly, really believe that out of nothing, everything was created. They say it, but I really don't believe, and I know you guys don't either. We really don't believe the atheists. This is why atheists are now the least trusted group in society. Did you know that? Because nobody believes them, and we don't even believe they believe what they're saying. We lack belief in atheists. So you guys have got to see this debate. Michael Squirmer gets destroyed. Now, Ken Hovind was very, very nice, always a gentleman. He's very kind in everything as he utterly destroyed Michael Squirmer. But you've got to check it out. Great debate. You know, It's just amazing, guys, that here in the year 2016, we still have unscientific people like atheists trying to convince us that DNA is a random chance and that, you know, the universe was created by nothing. You know, Lawrence Krauss, who I call the mad scientist, is actually going around the debate circuit saying nothing created everything. I do agree with the Bible when it says a fool says there is no God.